Thank you, Dr. Twinkle. A bit of a neglected subject, I would say. We are in an era of refractive cataract surgery, which has two components. One is to remove media opacity. The industry is behind this component, I would say, more than the other component. We are doing lens sacs and whatnot. But at the end of the day, you have removed the cataract with lens sacs or torsional ultrasound or an Ozel. But at the end of the day, what matters is the refractive error patient has post-op. So it is, we have to address the refractive component. We are all of us are behind the removal of the media opacity, and we feel this refractive component is being neglected. So one can address this subject in two ways. One is to address the spherical error, and again, second is the astigmatic error. So spherical error can be tackled with a proper IOL calculation. That is what we are here to discuss. And at the end of the day, you get a desired refractive outcome. So when a natural lens is replaced by IOL, the final refraction depends upon refractive power of the cornea and IOL, length of the eye along the visual axis, post-operative position of the IOL relative to the cornea, which is known as ELP, effective lens position. The important goal of these formulas is to continuously improve our ability to predict this ELP. So how do we do it? Personalization of the A constant. And do we really need it, or it's just a hype? So A constant depends upon the axial length of the eye, corneal radius, IOL power, refraction, and in Haggis formula, they also consider the pre-op anterior chamber depth. Any change in the following variables, axial length, corneal radius, power, or a refraction, or a depth, can change the A constant. Constant values vary according to the IOL design, material, and positioning within the eye as well. So why it is really needed? Why can't we use the A constant which is mentioned on the box or given by the companies? So today, patients, as I told, patients' expectation for an IOL implantation is as good as of those refractive patients. And unfortunately, because of the complexity of the intraocular lens power calculation process, a cataract surgeon may do everything perfectly with all latest instruments, but at the end of day, still end up with some amount of refractive error. So optimizing the A constant can help surgeons come closer to their target refractions. Personalizing constant can make a significant difference, but it does require time and effort. So most of us don't bother. In a typical state of art practice, the surgeon uses the latest optical biometry and modern techniques, but doesn't optimize. We get an IOL Master 500 or maybe 700 or a Lens Star, but if we don't optimize it, it's not going to give you the best results. Have a look at this chart. In the blue bar, if surgeon is using all good technology, the latest equipments, but he has not optimized his constant, most of the patient, see, almost less than 20% of the patient would be having, would remain within plus or minus 0.5 diopter after the surgery. And if all latest machine used and person has optimized his constant, the number of patient increases almost fourfold. Nearly 70% of the patient remains post op within 0.5 diopter spherical error. Second bar shows nearly 50% of the patient, if not optimized, nearly 50% of the patient, even after using IOL master or equivalent technology, remains within plus or minus one diopter. And if you optimize the same thing, nearly 100%, more than 90% of the patient would remain within one diopter postoperatively. Manufacturers' constants are problematic for several reasons. Those constants are average. The companies arrived at many years ago. When new lenses come out, manufacturers don't recalculate the constant for the new lenses. They just transfer the constant from a similar existing IOL. They say, look, the shape is same, the loops and the angulations are the same, only the material we have changed. According to a survey conducted by ASCRS, 10 years ago, around 95% of all biometries performed in the United States were contact ultrasound. The IOL industry prepared its constants for that market. And today, almost 80% of the US biometries are done using optical biometry or immersion ultrasound. Constants that work for contact ultrasound are not strong enough to produce optimum results using immersion or optical measurements. Some manufacturers, but not all, are aware of this and offer their customers optical biometric constant, most of the IOL vendors. Basically, the IOL industry has not yet fully reacted to the reality that biometry today calls for different constants. A surgeon with best setup who fails to optimize his constant could have less accurate outcomes than somebody who's using ordinary equipment, maybe an ultrasound A-scan, but who has optimized data has better results. An IOL constant like A constant or ACD constant are given by lens manufacturer are meant for an average setup. For a given surgeon's measurement setup, it is highly probable that the published IOL constant are less than optimum. Therefore, it is commonly agreed the published constants must be individualized, personalized, or optimized to make allowance for different measurement settings. Like if you are using an automated K-metry and you are using an ultrasound biometer, so the combination also needs to be kind of taken into the account. So how do we do it? So there are some published formulas, facilities with equipments are also available, and there are some websites which can do it for us. So record post-op refraction at 3 to 6 week follow-up visit. The data will tell you the overall effect of your instruments and technique on your outcomes. It will take anywhere from 20 to 50 cases to calculate your personal constant at outset, depending upon how meticulous you are. Some doctors make sure every instrument is functioning properly calibrated, and they always use same instrument and do everything exactly the same. But if you are changing your biometry patterns, your surgical patterns, then you might need more cases. So if you use particular setup for say 20 cases, that's more than enough. But if you keep changing your biometer and a keratometer and your incision sizes every time, it's very difficult to get a personalized A constant in a smaller data. If surgeons want to optimize their lens constant, they can do a reasonable good job using the software that comes with their biometer or IOL master. For more precise calculation, use standalone software like Dr. Holliday's, that is HIC, Holliday's IOL Consultant, or go to a website, Dr. Warren Hill, he would love to do that for you for free. This is the spreadsheet of Dr. Warren Hill, where you need to send your data and they will get back to you with the constant. More sophisticated machineries incorporates optimization programs such as Alcon, OcuScan and IOLMaster, which calculate a constant for the surgeon according to the values he inputs. IOLMaster 500 or 700, the latest one, it's easy, it's the most easiest machine where you can optimize a constant. A relatively smaller sample size of just 15 is needed. Why just 15? So, because they have a large data bank. There is a group which is known as user group of laser interference biometry, ULIB. The database available on IOLMaster has optimized lace constant of more than 270 IOL models. They have data bank of more than 50,000 patients from all over the world, and just 15 cases, and they can tell you your optimized A constant for the particular IOL and for the particular formula. This is the spreadsheet looks like. You have to fill in patient's name, surgery date, right or left eye, IOL power, post of refraction at 3 weeks. So I must say, one must do this. And many people feel we are still using the normal ultrasound biometry. Why should we do it? So even if you do it now, your A constant, there are formulas also available. Calibrate, or if you have your A constant on ultrasound with the available formula, you can apply that A constant into your optical biometer as well. You need not to do this exercise again. So there are generations of power formulas. I would be I'll just brief you with the modern formulas. So only difference between today's and older formulas is how we predict the effective lens position. That is the only difference. So ELP is the distance from the corneal vortex to the principal plane of IOL. So earlier, before 1980s, it was kept 4.5. In 81, one variable was used, that was axial length. In 88, two variables were added, that was axial length and keratometry. And in 1995, Olsen came with four variables, axial length, keratometry, ACD, and lens thickness. And in 1996, Dr. Holladay came with seven variables, axial length, keratometry, ACD, lens thickness, horizontal wide to wide, refraction, and age of the patient. So more measurements, more accuracy. So modern formulas, the theoretical ones, they are based upon optical properties of the eye. They do a better job of predicting post-op outcomes for long and short eyes. The Holladay, produced by Dr. Jack Holladay, has been considered to be the most accurate for eyes with axial length between 22 and 26. Hoffer Q, produced by Dr. Hoffer, it has been considered to be the most accurate for shorter eyes, less than 22. And SRKT, it's basically an empirical regression methodology for optimization of the post-operative ACD prediction of the retinal thickness correction factor and of the corneal refractive index. Haggis, this formula is accurate as the Holladay 2 for all eye lengths once optimized. If you have not optimized your Haggis formula, it doesn't work. Most other formulas only use one constant, such as ACD or A constant or effective lens position for a given IOL. Dr. Haggis algorithm uses three, A1, A2 and A0. So Haggis can be applied to all ranges of the axial length. The limitation is it requires preoperative ACD as additional value. And in 1993, Dr. Holladay led a worldwide study involving 34,000 patients. And have a look at these variables which he taken into the account. To the surprise, if you see, the horizontal other things that I think we all know, axial length, average case, mass, but then horizontal y to y, it is supposed to be, it is the third most important thing we should know before we calculate our IOL, and most of us are not doing that. So yeah, so this was the surprise came from the study. Limitation, it's little, it's not user friendly, it's expensive, and there you can also have a trial version for 30 days from the site. You can use it for free. Yeah. And so what to use, it's a dilemma. So many formulas, and I mean, how do we go about? So a very simple kind of thing we'll see here. So Holladay one works from normal to even extreme till almost 32.5. Hofer cube, best for shorter eyes, even less than 20 to say 25 or so. SRKT is best for normal eyes, 22 to almost 28, which we normally, so if you feel like, go for SRKT all the time, if unless the eye is very short. And if you optimize it and you avoid the steep K, even SRKT from normal to even extremely long eyes can be, it's more predictable. And of course, Haggis involves the whole range from extreme smaller to extreme larger eyes. And Holladay 2 has the widest kind of an application. You can use it from short eyes as short as maybe 17 or 18 to around 34. So, yeah, that is it. Thank you so much.